My name is Henny Fitzpatrick, and I know many, many of you, and the most important part of this for me is to be here at this moment at a crossroads again in integrative and bioregulatory medicine. And so the first thing I would like to do is take a moment for gratitude, because as we all know, taking that moment for gratitude is a very good idea. So if you haven't taken your moment for gratitude yet today, then please join me in doing that, because I can't tell you how important it's been, this journey, and how I find myself standing here at this moment right away. The journey is long and difficult, and the journey is very challenging, and the journey is full of such joy and such reward that I'm so glad that everybody came here today, because it means that you understand that, and that against all odds, if that's how sometimes your daily work feels, you're still in the fight, as I say. So one of the things that James invited me to do is talk a little bit about how I got here at this moment right now, and that would be several journals, if not books, of information. So I'll try to keep that short, because I would like to get through the slides that I have. And at the same time, what I encourage you to do is to look at the slides in your PowerPoint, because even if I don't get to all of the information, it's there, and it's something that you can go back to. So that's very good. So when I was thinking about how to give a quick summary, I think what I'll do is give little pieces of the quick summary as we go along this weekend. But it's been 20 years that since I first met biological regulatory medicine. And that seems to a lot of you like a long time, but the scary part is I had already been in practice for about 15 years before that. And so that makes me a crone. And I kind of hate to admit it, because I've tried to cling to being fully in middle age for a very long time. And I'm afraid, or actually not at all afraid, but I'm realizing that I have had such a lot of wonderful, varied experience that now I can consider myself, I don't know, at the end of, in the fall of my life, or maybe entering the winter. But what I want to say for those of you for whom 20 years is less than half your life, if 20 years is less than half your life, then you're looking at me thinking, oh my gosh, you know, she's one of those elderly females that they talk about in all of the case studies, at least in family medicine. And so what I want to say is that there are developmental phases that occur for all of us, starting at toddlerhood. We talk about infancy and the terrible twos, and we might talk about adolescence, and then we talk about early adulthood. But what I'm very certain of is that the developmental phase that begins in or towards the end of what we call middle age is stunning, and it really does only keep getting better. And as I stand here feeling like I'm coming full circle, and that the circle is continuing, I'm just really awestruck by the way that, you know, experiencing and fulfilling and continuing to try and to do and to try new things as you work with patients, no matter how you come at it, is the most rewarding thing in the whole world. So I just encourage all of you, no matter where you are in the stages of either your practice of medicine or your seeking care for yourself, don't give up. And you know, it all comes out very well. So 20 years ago, we had, back up a little bit more. So I went to medical school thinking that I would become a healer. And I was very, very, very happy to be in medical school, but I was very, very struck right away, without being able to put it into words, that there wasn't a lot of healing going on in medical school, even in the early 80s. and that there was some sort of a disconnect that nobody could help me express, because I had grown up in a family with two wonderful physicians as my parents, and there were a lot of us, and we weren't really pushed into medicine, but I really felt like it was sort of a calling from my very small childhood. But then when I got to medical school, as I look back on it, some of the seeds of why I'm standing here were begun to be planted, because there was a lot of meanness and competitiveness, and there was a lot, it was an underlying reality even in medical school. The attendings weren't very nice to us. You know, they make television shows about how you run around, you watch Grey's Anatomy, and they're always being put down, and there's much too much work to do and all of that. And that part of it was really hard for me. But even more hard for me was what was missing in the patient interaction. And again, I think that's gotten worse, but you know, even in the end of the 70s, the early 80s, patients stopped mattering as much as their physiology, but I couldn't put that into words. And so at that point, the most radical thing I could do was to go into family practice, which in my family, which was a new specialty. And the reason I was attracted to it was because it was the only medical subspecialty that had some sense of the fact that what was going on in the family or what the environment was like had an impact on health and wellness. But that was really a radical idea. And to my parents, one of whom was a psychiatrist and the other of whom was a pediatrician, it was really radical that I was going to go into family practice, because it was a brand new specialty and it was considered a non-specialty. And so here again, I'm like, but I'm going to go into family practice. And it was wonderful, but it was, again, very limited. Because the model of Western medicine, which is where I began, is limited. And that's why we're sitting here today. And so quickly, how many of us have that kind of training, MD or ND or DO? I'm just not sure. Because I do think that there's a big chasm between Western medicine and the rest of this medicine. And so I'm coming to this conference with the idea of trying to help create a bridge, first of all, for those of us who are who are trained in, sorry, that was really not intentional, who are trained in Western medicine. But there's also a chasm between the people who are integrated and didn't really get to learn Western medicine in medical school, because unfortunately, that medical school model is still the prevailing paradigm in our country and in our Western world, and it really inculcates the whole culture. You know, so that's something that I want to talk about a little bit today when I talk about, we did switch the lectures. Good. I don't know. Oh, no, never mind. This is the right lecture. So part of what I'm interested in doing is bridging that gap between, you know, are you integrated or natural or holistic or bioregulatory, or are you a Western physician? Because as we know, they don't talk very much. And I think in groups like this, we can talk, but that I think that the prevailing model out there is still really a difficult one, and that's something else we need to figure out how to bridge. And so after my residency, I married someone from medical school, and we joined the National Health Service Corps, which was a remarkable introduction for me into different ways of understanding health and wellness, partly because what that meant was that we were assigned to different places in the world where there were underserved people. And underserved people don't have access to care, and they tend to have a real ancient wisdom in the sense of a culture, what James was talking about, like an old sense of health and wellness, and that they definitely had to keep that sort of secret. But at the same time, I had an idea of what we would do if you couldn't afford the medicine or you couldn't afford the test. And so the 15 years that we spent traveling around, we were in a couple of migrant clinics. We went to Tiffin, Ohio, where people hand-pick tomatoes for Heinz. And this was in the mid-80s, and the rashes that I saw come into my clinic just astounded me. But there was very little written about the sprays then. That was all just coming into my purview anyway. And so, you know, I would go and visit where they were housed, quote unquote, because the companies would invite them to come and pick tomatoes by hand, and that they would be well cared for. They would be, you know, paid and put up into lodging. But that's a whole separate topic. But it was a very interesting way of understanding this inner world of integrative medicine. We also had some time on the Oneida Indian Reservation, 2 or 3 years, which is, we were in Wisconsin at that time. And there's a really wonderful, you know, Native American spirituality that inculcates their medicine, because to them it's not separate. The world, everything in the world and us is all one. So those kinds of ideas really helped me. And after the National Health Service Corps, we ended up in Santa Fe, New Mexico, partly because it's a beautiful place. We had grown up on the East Coast. We had 5 kids at that point, and we wanted to go to a different kind of a place. And so I'm going to leave my personal story there, but after coming to Santa Fe, New Mexico, I'll just say one more piece, that about 20 years ago, right now, I was at a cocktail party or a Christmas party, having just moved my whole life into New Mexico, and a naturopath came up to me and we just started to talk. And at that point, internally, I was feeling very lost, because actually, now that I wasn't in the National Health Service Corps, allopathic medicine had become kind of boring. And I don't know how many of you have ever thought about it. If you're a physician, or if you aren't, then you probably don't know. But it actually is kind of boring, because you are given a formula. And I was really good at giving everybody that I met the right medicine. I think I did the protocols really well. And I probably cared a little bit more than other people do. But I couldn't make people well. And that was like the first of my many midlife crises, which was when we got to New Mexico and I got to decide what I wanted to do, I kind of had this secret, which was that I didn't like what I was doing, partly because I wasn't making people well, and partly because it was really boring. It was not intellectually challenging. And so as we stand here today, and you know, I kind of give my little words of crone wisdom, the first thing I would say is that don't be scared of gathering as many tools as you can. So James just gave us this really wonderful rundown of all the tools that are out there. And I think all of us have a tendency to feel like it's kind of too much, and how do we apply all of this? But I think that the very first thing is that the art of this and the science is that the more tools you have, the better. And you know, that there's always a way to help somebody get better. And and that if you have a big toolbox, never stop filling your toolbox. You can't use everything, you can't apply everything, but you can definitely go back to that toolbox and try something new. Okay, so I'll go back to the history of Henny later. And what I thought I would do today was actually talk from an allopathic model, because the one thing that I do want to say in defense of medical school, which is that underneath all of the kind of pharmaceutical training and everything else, that sort of this idea of systems thinking, you know, that when the coding, some of you may know this. Does everybody know about coding? You know, medical insurance coding. So we abandoned ICD-9 2 or 3 years ago, and now we have ICD-10, and I think we're up to 100,000 different anomalies. And that we went from about 20,000 in ICD-9, which is this book that's this thick, and now the book is this thick, and in order for insurance to pay, you have to get it exactly right. And so that thinking, that says it all. That's what's wrong here. But I also want to make sure that, at least in this lecture, that I present what's happening in the United States as the integrative medicine that comes from physiology. Because an understanding of physiology is remarkable. And I think often if you weren't trained in sort of standard Western allopathic medicine, you may not know how to approach physiology. But one of the things that's so attractive to all of us as physicians anyway is the beauty and the awe that that always inspires me when I really dive into understanding how we're sitting here with our hearts pumping and our stresses put behind us and listening and functioning all of the time. This is sensitive. So I'm just going to get into the lecture, and time bullies us. Time definitely bullies me. And so we'll get as far as we get, and then you can look at the rest, or we'll pick it up later. Here's a really good model. You know, we don't very often diagram allopathic medicine, but here we have obesity. We're going around a circle. That's good. It's circular, not linear. We have obesity. We have low back pain, depression, diabetes, GERD, hypertension, dyslipidemia, that means high cholesterol, headache. This is just one little go-around. These are the chronic standard illnesses of the 21st century. And then the arrows point to the medicines, and the circle is surrounded by dollars. So that's one model. And what I want to do is to kind of put together my journey, because this is the model that I kind of started with. And to learn pharmacology, those of you who had to learn our pharmacology, it's terrible. It's really terrible. No matter what kind of a student you are, and no matter how astute you are, it's just overwhelming. And so I can say that, now I'm certified in integrative medicine and also in functional medicine, because those are some American boards that can give me some status. But I can't successfully recertify in family medicine because I can't follow these medicines anymore. Maybe that's a good sign, but pharmacology is just, it's cumbersome and it's detailed and it's really really overwhelming. So one of the things that I had to understand, or one of the things that was like an aha that gave me such hope, was that a lot of what medicine is about, no matter where you enter it, is that it is the biology of energy transformation and energy exchange within and between living things and their environments. And so I want to talk about the things that now are being translated into physiology, which somehow gives it ratification, so that if you can make a language, if you can talk a physiology language to both your customers and your colleagues, then it sort of helps. But this human body field definitely exists, and it definitely has everything to do with our well-being. The problem is that in Western medicine, you are never supposed to really understand the energetics of the person, because that would get in the way of choosing the right diagnosis and then the right drug. That was a really linear system, and of course we are bioenergetic in every way. And so I'm glad that James already put this together, but one of the things I did as I entered biological medicine was to try to understand how each of these WISE systems does have an interaction, and it's helpful to make your own chart, which is what I did, or to use some of the charts that James had, where, if you're dealing with the cerebral cortex, you can go back energetically to the fact that that's sort of the crown chakra. And if you're dealing with the limbic system or the thyroid, that really is the same as the fifth chakra. And this chart that I made goes across two or three poster boards because it keeps going. But so sometimes the way in with somebody is to either take the physiology or the energetic and translate one into the other. I also was very interested when I learned biological medicine about this idea of meridian themes, which to an acupuncturist, and by the way, for me to really become, these other systems that James so very nicely outlined are really complex, and they take years and years of experience and learning to understand. And in biological medicine, we can get tastes of them and we can use them to a certain extent. But the thoroughness with which you need to become a TCM practitioner or an Ayurvedic physician or an allopathic physician, the thoroughness and the amount of study and kind of understanding, it's a full-time job. And so you know, you have to get a taste of all of the rest, but you come from one way or another. But there is a way to use these meridian themes in trying to help people understand why they're hurting and what way they're hurting. And so that if they have stomach trouble, you can go to one of these themes. These are the positive ones. They're negative ones too, but I was trying not to put those. But you know that there's the strengths and the weaknesses are represented from other systems, and they really can become a common language. So these are here for you, and they can be very, very useful because, well, for two reasons. First of all, because they give people an understanding of what a lot of people are horrified or terrified by, the idea that there's energetics or that there's meridian themes or that your organs have a sense. You know, in standard physiology, you want your liver to just be this big organ that's very vascular that sits in the right upper quadrant. We don't want it to have much to do with this. But if you have a human being in your room who can't understand why they can't get rid of their liver disease, if you're wise enough to go back and say, well, is it anger? I mean, a good example is a lot of people who have chronic cough. You can do everything you know how to do to get rid of that chronic cough, but then if one day you ask them, do you have old grief? And then you just move on. It's those are the kinds of interactions that I think are really important. And it's so much fun. And so, you know, we're going to mentor each other, and we're going to be part of a big organization that continues to put these ideas together, because there's as many different ideas and ways of doing this as there are people in the world. And, you know, so that can actually keep us going for a very long time. So I thought this was, you know, we talk about feelings. And I thought this was a very interesting thing, actually, from a sleep magazine about the feeling wheel. And it's much more complicated than you need. But, you know, feeling can be very fine-tuned. And in allopathic medicine, you pretty much never ask Mrs. So-and-so how she really feels. And so I think that what I'm going to do with the rest of this lecture is to just give you a few little ideas of how to think. Because I think when you come to a lecture like this, or when we come together, you're just aware of what you don't know or what you don't do or what you've avoided learning because it doesn't make any sense. And so what I'm going to offer is that there is a place to start. And the first thing to do is to just start thinking in terms of patterns and trying to recognize patterns. And that begins with the patient story. How many of you have had patients that come in who, after you get them, allow them to tell the whole story, just heave a sigh of relief? I have it happen all the time, and sometimes I have to be in a hurry, and sometimes I have to hold that first appointment to something very short. But you let them tell the story, and they look at you and they say, a physician has never let me tell the whole story. So if you're looking around to figure out if you have the right modalities to make this person better, just let them tell the whole story and listen without knowing what you're going to do. That's a good thing in all of our lives. If you're, you know, listening to someone, try to just listen and not to decide immediately what category and what are we going to do. It's just an exercise. I think the other thing is that it really is true that every patient encounter is unique and gives you an opportunity to develop your clinical acumen and your intuition. One of the remarkable permissions I was given when I started in biological medicine was the idea that I had an intuition, that I had a way of understanding people, which I developed, that was actually useful. Because I had that intuition all along. It's not a judgment, it's a tuning in. But I remember one of the doctors who was my first mentor who said, oh yeah, some people have it and some people don't, and you can make yours better, and it really counts. And that was just a really amazing permission for me. So you do have an intuition. You don't have to be psychic. You don't have to be whatever else we call it. But you do have an intuition. And if you keep doing this and keep experiencing it and having one experience after another, it'll get better and better. That's what makes it fun. So the idea of integrative medicine, again, is very splintered in the United States, maybe less so in Western Europe. And luckily, I feel very lucky to have entered integrative medicine through the biological regulatory medicine model before the other models that I encountered in the United States. But the Western model definitely falls short, and yet the physiological basis for health and disease is very useful and very precise. And it seems like there's a tendency to practice either energetic medicine or physiological medicine. And we're here now and into the future to stop that divide. And we have to really understand a common language. And so this afternoon I'll talk more specifically about the matrix, which is just an amazing concept to me. But matrix does encompass body, mind, and spirit. And of course, allopathic physicians want to take the body and divide it into 1,000 little pieces and forget about the mind and the spirit. It doesn't work very well. But I'm saying something different. I'm saying that it's important to understand the body as well. So I don't know if any of you have, I'm not here at all to promote any kind of medicine, but I've been intrigued by functional medicine actually because at a biomedical conference that I was at 20 years ago, or a little less maybe, Mark Hyman, who is behind functional medicine, spoke at one of our conferences as a guest speaker because he had written an introduction to Thomas Rao's book. And I hadn't heard about Mark Hyman. It's amazing how like divided we were back then and still are. But I think that what functional medicine is doing as far as understanding a way to map physiology so that it's accessible to everybody is useful. So this is the functional medicine matrix. And when I present my case tomorrow, I'm going to use this a little bit just so that you have a taste of what it is, because it's a useful way from people who don't understand anything about bioregulatory medicine to kind of enter and not be scared by it. So I feel like it's a useful way to understand the physiological system. It's useful to explain to your patients. Don't forget that your patients do have a right to understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. And if they say, no, that's too much, or you know, they're saying, that seems like voodoo, then back off a little bit because you are, you know, going into their system and rearranging it. So it's always good to access the patient's energy in a way that they feel like they understand. The last one is that the model I just showed you is not mine. So I think it's very important to remember that we hold residues and traces within ourselves of everything that ever happens to us. And the story of the telltale heart was very popular a couple of decades ago, but it's the story of a little girl who received a heart transplant when she was about 7. And it was a life-saving procedure, and when she woke up from the surgery, she started talking very negatively about this experience, and she was talking about being abducted and being hurt and eventually almost being killed. And it turned out that the donor, who was also about her age, had indeed been abducted and murdered, I think, or close, so that's why her heart came up for donation. But what happened was that the organ itself held memory. And so if you remember that our cells hold memory of everything, which of course was astounding, I just have to say, and made the news because it helped us stop, you know, catch the guy who had done it. And you know, these are the kinds of stories that as I'm bogging down during my daily life, I remember. But don't forget that you hold a residue of everything that ever happened to you, and it informs your illness, and that the patient will give you everything he or she needs to recover. You just have to listen. I begin with a written history form. I think the more detailed, the better. Often people sigh and sort of kick and scream because it takes a few minutes to fill it out. But often I get the feedback that nobody's asked so many questions, and that by being so thorough about every aspect of your life as you write the history, they understand that it really matters to them. Don't forget about family illness and significant illnesses and genetic illnesses, which I'm going to spend a whole hour on because I think that genetic models are excellent, and I also think that what's happening in genetics is still very much that cause and effect, and there's some danger in that, except if you understand biological regulatory medicine. I'll talk more about that. I think it's very important to ask the patient what they want, because I remember having a woman, when I was sort of young at this in Santa Fe, a woman came in and had terrible headaches, and we went through the whole business, and I got very excited, and I said, I think I can make your headaches go away, and she grabbed me, and she said, I'm not ready for that. And I'm like, I was just like, she was like, I'm not ready to let go. I mean, she was sort of mad. She's like, how, make them go away. But that's, she said it out loud. What often people understand is that we are in a balance. Our matrixes are sort of balancing. We're regulating at all times. And so sometimes it takes a long time. I don't think she did get rid of her headaches altogether. We got them better so that she could tolerate life better, but we didn't really get completely gone. I'm not making fun of anybody. I'm just saying make sure that your goals and the patient's goals concur. And make sure you keep understanding. I think especially in this country where there's so much information, it's really important for people to understand your thinking as much as you can. And I think in regular medicine, Western medicine, you go in and they tell you what to do and you go home and do it, and then, you know, there's no talking, there's no nonsense about that. And so, again, retelling the patient story is important. Often at the end of my intake, I just quickly say, so this is what I heard, because sometimes you didn't hear it right. And then the energetic connection with each patient is essential. You need to sit by them, you need to touch them, you need to be present with them. And then I think it's very interesting to understand physiology from the view of the matrix. And so I give as an example, a very simple example, which is in my oldest daughter works in Harlem in a very underserved school. And, you know, they now do studies in the double-blinded controlled literature which show that if you feed children good, healthy protein, this is what the breakfast program is from, except that the breakfasts they give are sort of crummy still. But the idea that we had to study the idea that academic performance increases with good nutrition, at least we know that. But I'm saying that we want to keep on developing these connections between the Western medicine world and the other world. I think that this speaks for itself. There's all kinds of different clues and patterns. And I think that often, in the Western world, if you have food allergies or if you have gluten sensitivity, you think that that should be this kind of a symptom. But that this is saying that all symptoms cross with each other, and you can't just look at a set of symptoms and know the diagnosis. But that's the way we were treated. That's the way we were taught to think. And so, you know, here I list all kinds of things that people might come in with, all different patterns and combinations. And in the olden days, you would say, okay, they have eczema, so then we do this for them. So that must be a skin allergy, or that must be something else. And, you know, looking at all of these different symptoms, you think, well, which disease is she actually getting at? And the whole idea is we have no idea which disease it is. And if you can let go of understanding which disease it is, you'll be better off. Because what you're trying to do is to restore that balance and help the body heal itself. And I think that we get hung up on the diagnosis. So can we treat cancer? Well, cancer is one of those things where, you know, we're all, not all of us, but I mean the culture in general is terrified by the whole idea of cancer. And you have to eradicate the cancer, and usually we do that at the expense of the entire system. But any of these illnesses are all part of the same person and the same illness. And so when you list the symptoms and ask for the treatment plan, it really depends on all of the different, let me go back to that. It depends on all of the different pieces of the puzzle. So we got to go back to the puzzle and the history, and don't worry too much about this. I mean, I think a good example of it is probably you have people calling your office saying, do you treat, what did I have the other day? I don't know, you know, some long series of Latin words. Do you treat this? Does Dr. Henny treat this? And I just taught my front desk person not to write the thing down, but to just say yes, we can make everything better. Because people in your own mind as a patient, if you get diagnosed with this series of Latin words, you think doom, and then you go to the literature and it looks like doom. So forget about that. That's all I'm saying. And let's start with some of the very simple things. So, if you don't know anything else, please help people understand that food is information and that eating is really primal to all of us. We love to eat. We love to eat all kinds of foods. If the treatment plan you do diet-wise is stressful to the person, it's not a good thing. And so we can talk, I mean, I think there's all kinds of different diets and all of that, but I think that the best thing to do is to get the person to eat pure whole foods in all kinds of different colors that were grown on the earth. And you'd be surprised how hard that is for a lot of people. You know, remember that digestion and assimilation, these are now parts of the functional medicine matrix, are so, so important. And that this microcosm, microflora in your intestine has everything to do with all of the rest of your health. So if you're just starting out, and I would encourage you, after you go home from this conference, just try something different in your office. Don't be scared. And if you're allopathically trained, you're going to be scared, because we were taught in a very, very clear way that, you know, you do way, and otherwise you're risking all kinds of things. And so one of the things I was thinking about as I was planning for this lecture is that I actually was studying biological medicine, and I started to practice it sort of at the same time. And I don't know how I really gave myself permission to do that, but there was something that really drew me to it. So I learned about chelation and dark field microscopy, and I was so intrigued that before I completely mastered it, like you're supposed to do in medical school to pass those tests and learn all the pharmacology, I just started doing it with people, and I did it in a way that it was an exchange. So, you know, I was doing IV therapy on people, and it's not cavalier, it's in the name of helping and upbuilding people, but not being terrified that you need to, you know, that you're gonna hurt somebody, because the nice thing about this is that we're helping people, really helping people, and we're not hurting people. But it's a big thing to understand. Remember, if people don't have a good microflora, then nothing that you give them will be properly absorbed. And there's all kinds of micronutrient disorders, tiny little micronutrient disorders that prevent you from ever getting well. Remember that all of the immune system, or 80% of the immune system, starts in your intestines, you know, and so when you think of this sad diet that we have, which is the standard American diet, you can spend your entire practice of medicine trying to help people to get away from that, and it's really hard, but it's done a lot of damage. And I think you also meet a lot of people who end up, they have a word for it, orthomolecular anorexia. My friend Ian taught me that. That means you can't eat anything, and that's a real sadness. So get your people to eat. Sitting down to nice food and eating it and enjoying it and assimilating it is kind of basic. So, you know, again, in my part of some of the integrative medicine, we have to avoid everything. It's that puritanical idea that everything is bad for you, and that there's no kind of joy and just kind of voluptuous being embodied. And it's really something that we have to fight against. And so, you know, eating is a good thing. I know people have food sensitivities. I know that, and it's fine to have that be the basis. But the eventual idea is that you just eat all the good whole foods, but that you avoid as much as you can. Not you avoid the crap, because because there's a colonized resistance against pathogens. And so if you avoid the crap, you actually feed your colonized resistance against pathogens. I'm going to get into this more when I get into the genetics, but remember that the role of the intestinal microflora is to protect ourselves against the constant bombardment of all of the xenobiotics that are in our environment. And you know, we're in a crisis in the environmental information that's given to our children. And so I think we do have a resilience, and I think we can that we can tolerate a lot of things, but it all starts by making sure that you have good microflora, because it's they that prevent you from getting sick from the residues of drugs that are in all of our water and our soil. I'm also trying to give you some ideas about the cross reactivity. You know, you're either an endocrinologist or you're a GI doctor, and the two don't actually ever come together, but actually the endocrine system and that microflora in your gut are all one. And so in addition to, you know, fixing the glands, make sure that you fix the microflora too. Nature is a remarkable, remarkable wise, old system, and we can really rely on her. And so when you look at the physiology of the body and understand that every system affects every other system, it's kind of magic. So here are some of the functions of the gut metagenome. My joke about this is somebody comes in with itchy skin and I say, poop in this cup, and they look at me and think, she's really not listening. You know, or they come in and say, I'm really depressed, and I say, I gotta get some of your poop and some of your spit, and they're thinking, she's really not listening. But really, the gut biome has everything to do with everything. That's what this slide says. And that it's not so easy to maintain. You can have what you think of as perfect digestion, meaning that you have a good bowel movement and no digestive pain, and still have a big mess with this. I'm doing a lot of work right now with pediatrics, and a lot of my focus is on the fact that what's growing, I do some stool cultures, and what's growing in the guts of one-year-olds, and I'm talking about one-year-olds in a community of people who are, there really is a website in New Jersey called the Earthy Crunchy Moms and the Earthy Crunchy Crunchy Moms. Is that right? I think it's something like that. I mean, this is for real, and they kind of vie in their crunchiness. And so these are people, all I'm saying is that these are people who are very aware and read everything and protect their children as much as they can. And they come in and their little boy is running all over the place, or he's got rage and trigger problems and he's about to get a label and put on medications. And I say, let's check that microbiome. And what you find is quite remarkable. And even if they say, well, he's never had an antibiotic and he has good bowel movements every day, it's insidious. But one of the ways to help little children with their mood and with their behavior is to fix the microbiome. So then moving on to the communications part of the functional medicine matrix, we're talking about hormones and neurotransmitters. And what I wanted to do in this lecture is to just give you a little taste of the way there are these wonderful interactions. And if this is the way that you know, if you're doing traditional Chinese medicine or if you're doing Ayurveda, you have different systems. But in a way, there's a common language underneath. And eventually, we'll be able to speak all the languages. But understanding this part of the language is, first of all, helpful for the patient, but also it gives you a different understanding of why physiology is helpful. So again, there's this whole continuum, which they call the HPA-TGAG axis, which means hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal, thyroid, gastrointestinal, gonadal, what's the other A? I don't know, but insulin's in there too, so pancreatic is in there as well. But remember that often you'll have somebody who specializes in hormone treatment, and that usually means that they give reproductive hormones or they give thyroid, or sometimes they give both. And even within the way that we treat and support thyroid, if you're in a very classic allopathic model, isn't enough, because you have to treat all of the hormones and neurotransmitters as one system. And so a lot of, you'll go to, on the web, there's a lot of people who will evaluate your hormones, like your thyroid or your reproductive hormones, but that won't really work unless you understand the whole system of it. And so that's what I'm talking about here. And it starts with James already touched on this. This is like a physiological diagram of the way that we can process stress in our systems. And I won't get into all of that, but everything is stress. And so, all of the medical literature is now talking about inflammatory diseases, and they're saying, oh, even cardiovascular disease is inflammatory disease. And the idea is that to your body, stress is stress. So if you have psycho-emotional stress from your childhood, and you eat the standard American diet, and you're bullied by time, all of those are stressing the system. I'll talk about that more. But this system is a very delicate system that protects us, that allows us to go on even though bad things happen to us. And this is a lot in the news, that you have a lot of psycho-emotional stress, but there's a physiology to that, and it informs all of the glands and all of the immune system. So that if you have a lot of if you have a lot of stress in your system, that takes your immune system down. And so there, you know, if you have psycho-emotional stress, your white cell count and the subsets of that will be less. So you can either access by fixing the stress, or you can try to support the production of white cells, but all are the same way of thinking all the way through this. And so, you know, hormones are messaged by the pituitary in this model. Adrenals are the first hormone that always need to be repaired, and I think we forget that. A lot of regular physicians or people who are dabbling in physiology forget about the adrenals. They're harder to test. But until you have good adrenal rhythm, if you don't have a good adrenal rhythm, because that informs the fight or flight, it doesn't matter if you have good thyroid or good the rest of your systems, including your blood sugar. So I keep diverging, but I take care of a lot of type 2 diabetes because that is a terrible epidemic in this country. And if you would fix their adrenals, their blood sugar will regulate. And that does mean trying to introduce them to some of our bioregulatory techniques for discharging stress and distress. But we never think of going back and fixing the trauma of the veterans who are dying of type 2 diabetes, because that has nothing to do with it, but actually it has everything to do with it. So I'm just trying to bring in all of these connections. And now that we have a physiology of it, it's really interesting because somehow that validates it. We've known that it's true for a long time, but if you understand that there's a physiology, that kind of validates it, which is what this says. And so again, if your adrenal response is disrupted, and whose isn't, because we live in the world that we live in, then it's going to impact thyroid, blood sugar, insulin, cholesterol. That's the whole cascade of heart disease, cytokines, lungs. It'll make you have asthma. It'll make you have eczema, all of that. The allopathic medicine people hate this, but it's true, and it's such a good tool. So I don't think I'll go through all of this. Just look at the pearl at the bottom, which is to make sure you get your adrenals fixed. And there's lots of ways of doing that. And then that there's a rhythm in all of this. There's also wonderful rhythm. Somebody just won, it's funny. There were three doctors, I think, just won a Nobel Prize for two or three doctors just won a Nobel Prize for understanding circadian rhythm. And that's exciting, and it's true, and I'm glad that they're doing that. To me, circadian rhythm means more of that circle chart that James showed us, that everything has a rhythm and a time of day and a sort of a process. Body sort of this master mind trying to regulate everything. But what I heard as a little news description was that they had discovered three proteins that were there that are now the bioregulatory, the circadian rhythm hormones. And when I hear that, I thought, it's not three proteins, guys, and that's not worth, I hope you guys understand it. It's great that we understand that there are circadian rhythms, but it's not three proteins. And that thinking is what comes into the news, and that science is what we're way beyond. So I'm sure it is three proteins, so glad we can map those, but giving those back or something like that is just not going to help. Does everybody understand what I'm saying by that? Because I keep, when we talk about genetics, it may be sort of astounding, but just remember that we are very complicated systems, and that still what we reward is a simplification, a cause and effect. And so, anyway, I'll show you that later. So again, adrenals first. Energetic treatments will be much more effective if you support the physical body, which means diet. And, you know, diet and attention to stress and sleeping, and also if you have people that are taking pharmaceuticals that are trying to support neurotransmitters, remember that neurotransmitters and hormones to your body are the same, and they cross-react and they interact. And so, for instance, I'm just trying to give for instances, if you have somebody with polycystic ovaries, if you fix their adrenal and repair their GABA, which is a neurotransmitter, then they're going to get better. But if you just put them on birth control, they probably won't. And so the content of these slides isn't as important. If you don't know what these things are, what I want you to understand is that the underlying thinking is what's so fun, and that you can keep learning this and understanding it, and that's how your toolbox gets bigger and bigger. And all of us need to do that, and then we need to talk about it. And so, going back to the idea of stressors, And in bioregulatory medicine, we didn't show the toxic barrel, but the model is that over a lifetime, stressors build up. But what stressors are everything. And so it's partly what we get from our water and from our environment. It's partly because our soil is diminished. It's partly because we're in despair, because I think our world is really, if you are awake in any way, and even if you try to be asleep by not listening to the news, you know, that we really are at a time of great changing. And that's why we're sitting in this room right this minute. We are at the time when, at a crossroads, when there's either going to be a turning towards emotional and spiritual evolution, or we're going to extinct ourselves as a species. And I don't think there's any human being, and I think it probably affects even little children, that reality, you know, so that we're all in grief, and that's a stress too. And so you might as well say it out loud, but the number of things that stress us, and the number of ways in which we're isolated, and the number of ways our culture has kind of taken us over in every level, not just in medical treatment, impact everything. So remember that stress then stops your immune system from working. It takes away your well-being. It stops you from sleeping, all of those things. But when you start eliminating stresses, you'll never run out of things on the list. And then I wanted to say a couple of words about detoxification and transformation. James and I didn't share what we were going to say in our initial lectures, but we're saying the same thing. We're just saying it in another way. So one of the key things to do is to remember that we're all toxic, that we can tolerate a lot of those loads, but that I think that we have to remember that the more you can, that we have resilience in our liver systems and in our detoxification systems, sweat and breathing out and all of those systems, but that we really have to always be keeping up with that. So since World War II, we've dumped over 80,000, I think it's higher than that, that's enough, chemicals into the environment. If you ever look about what the EPA says about those chemicals, is that they have this rating called generally regarded as safe. That's nonsense. Generally regarded as safe. So, you know, there is in other thinking the idea that we should live by the precautionary principle, which is if it might be toxic, we probably ought to wait till we're sure it's not. But that's exactly opposite, and we don't even pay attention that everything is related, generally regarded as safe. So chemical residues are present in every living being on Earth. They did studies of cord blood in middle income people in the United States, and the babies were born with over 200 chemical residues. That's everywhere. That's for us. It's okay, because if you can understand how to rebuild people, take care of all of their stressors, you know, we are resilient. But just don't forget that you can't really be separate from that. And I think that it's very interesting to understand that when they talk about the safe level of these toxic toxins, they're talking about parts per million or parts per billion. And so when I lecture on this, and maybe we can get into this in some of our small groups, but when you're talking about part per billion, you picture a train that's a mile long that is all tanker cars, and each tanker car holds water, and it holds 200,000 gallons of water in each tanker car, and it's a mile long, and one drop of a toxin is a part per billion. So when they throw these things around, it's important, it's kind of stark, and you can put this away when you leave, but when you throw these ideas around that this is only parts per billion, so it's safe, think again. And we have these resilient bodies. Anyway, they disrupt our endocrine systems. They do that at a very early basis. A lot of these chemicals, which are called POPs, or persistent organic pollutants, store in our body fat. So if you ever have a patient who's struggling with too much body fat, and whenever they go on a diet, they tell you they feel bad, that's because they're dumping all kinds of toxins. So you know, we all want to lose weight. I understand that completely. But just don't forget that the body actually uses fat, that some of the reason so many people are obese is because they're toxic. And so be careful as you help them come to a better body weight that you do something about those toxins, and that you tell them that this is the means to an end. So, yeah, I just said that. I do this. I say what I'm going to say instead of switching to the slide. So when we talk about protecting the liver, you know, I already said that you have to get rid of your deep anger. That's one thing you can do. And there's all kinds of therapies to detoxify the liver. And that when we think of the physiology of liver detoxification, there's two phases, a phase one and a phase two. And that the most important way of supporting those is to make sure that you are not constipated and that you do not become dehydrated. How many of you have people who say, it's regular for me to poop every 3 days? The children, the pediatricians tell the moms, if the child doesn't poop before one every week, except every week, that's normal. Well, it's not really normal. That idea is just crazy. So avoid constipation. And remember to provide micronutrients and to make sure that they're being absorbed. So a lot of the testing that we do is to these means, and once you have it on, once in my model anyway, if I have an idea of what it is I'm trying to do, it helps me order the way that I go about helping the person get well. And I think depending on the model, it will change the way that you approach the patient. Because part of the conundrum as you go into a very complicated patient and you're trying to untangle it is sort of where to begin. And so I think there's all sorts of ways of trying to make a map and then understanding where you might get the gentlest and the quickest impact. Exercise is so important, and that just means movement. And so again, I think as we get high into bioregulatory medicine, we forget the basic things like exercise, stress management, sleep, good, clean, whole, healthy foods. But exercise is really important. That doesn't mean you have to get on a treadmill and beat yourself up. It means that people really need to move without headphones on every day. And I mean move in a way that's fun and that's useful, but there's a lot of studies that say that if we could put exercise in a bottle and prescribe it, it would cure everything. So I just gave some other pieces. And then I just wanted to reiterate what James already said, which is that we need to support the detoxification organs. Skin is the first one. It's the biggest surface area. And you know, a lot of exposures come through skin. There's a website called Not So Pretty, and it was about the phthalates that get into women during pregnancy. Phthalates starts with a PHT. It's a good Scrabble word. But you know, they did a big study about how phthalates that get into people through the skin really hurt developing fetuses. And I think that a lot of us feel like we're kind of chemical free, and then we put something like 26 chemicals a day on our skin because there's all kinds of stuff and crap in the stuff that we use. So make your patients aware of that. One way to detoxify skin is through sweating, which means saunas and sweat treatments, but also just good old-fashioned exercise. Skin brushing is a good one. The lungs detoxify all the time. So teach your people breathing techniques, and you can nebulize remedies. That's a really good thing. A lot of asthmatics come in and they use medications in there. But if you nebulize the homeopathic and homotoxicological, all of the kinds of gentle remedies, you're actually making airborne the medicine, and it just gets taken into the lungs. And so having a nebulizer in your office is a very good thing, and it looks like a standard treatment. And so depends on what you put in it. Nasal therapy is very, very important. If you don't know what that is, you'll learn at one of these conferences. But it's a way of infusing the sinuses with wonderful remedies directly. And remember that anything that's going on in your sinuses is also going on in your gut. And there's these wonderful maps of which sinus you have congested and then which sinus the ENTs go in and ream out with a little drill. So that is a map to the intestinal flora too. And I guess we're going to have a really good talk later about the biology in the mouth. But it's actually all one system from the mouth all the way through to the Neverland. and you know, you can't really skip actually from the sinuses all the way through one system, and we share everything. Imagine if when the ENTs actually say we've got to heal the flora in your intestine, that'll be the day that we get Nobel Prizes out there, because you know that is nasty down there, and what's in the sinuses you can just clean up with a suction. Lymph drainage is another system of drainage that we don't in allopathic medicine pay much attention to. We take people's lymph nodes out after they've had cancer, you know, and then we say, well, your arm might swell. It's a breast cancer. You know, if it's a prostate cancer, your leg might swell or your whole groin. But we sort of say that as a, oh, by the way, you know, but don't worry because your cancer will be gone. Your lymph is very, very important. I was recently reading an article about how they discovered the lymph system of the brain. And so this is just a little bit of cocktail talk, but that there are these wonderful lymph drainage systems in the cerebral cortex, which allopathic medicine didn't think existed, but now that we've discovered them and can map them, then it means that any kind of psychological or emotional trouble that manifests can help with lymph drainage. So I think that the matrix of physiology is really a useful model to help strategize about the complex and individual interactions and interdependencies in the human milieu, and I'm going to talk about the milieu this afternoon. And so as I leave this lecture, collaboration, if we want to think of the points about what we can do to make a successful practice, it's all about collaboration. And so as you build your toolbox, build your collaboration with people who have thinking about this, and just share. It's information sharing. It's all, everybody has a piece of the wisdom, and that to have a forum where we can actually share that with no, it's not about whether your office makes enough money or whether you get all the patients or whether you're an expert in, it's just the way our Western culture makes us. It's whether you're an expert in thyroid or whether you're an expert in some bioenergetic treatment. It's all of it. And we all have not us, but the world has a resistance to that. We still want all of this linear thinking. But I'm saying that learn as much as you can and then just talk. Talk even though you don't know all the high terms. And if you don't understand what your colleague does because it's this big system that you think you should know of, that they call by their brand name, just ask them what it is. People say that to me all the time. You know, they're coming like I'm some wise bioregulatory physician, and they say, do you know the blah, blah, blah? And I'm like, nope. And they're like, you don't know the blah, blah, blah? That is the thing. If you don't have that, you really don't have much. It's true, you know. But I just say, well, I don't know what that is. And then they tell me, and I'm like, oh, that, yeah, I know what that is. Yeah. It's bioregulatory medicine. And then I also think that there are as many paths to wellness as there are people on Earth, and there are as many plans for health and wellness as there are physicians, healthcare practitioners, and practitioners of all sorts of things, as many of those as there are on the Earth. There are illnesses, and we are gonna change the system. So thank you.